What's going on, folks? Hope you're having a wonderful night or day. Happy holidays. Today, we're going to be having a big discussion of a Q&A that was held with one of my favorite news sites and Aaron Flynn from Inflexion Games. There's multiple sections to this and a lot of good detail, so we're going to go by this one by one. First question is, can you tell us more about the history and the universe? They say that our game is set in 1889, just after the collapse of a portal network. All of our players, the Realm Walkers, find themselves lost in these strange and mysterious realms. They must find a way to return home and return to Nightingale, the magical town they know, which is also classified as the last haven of humanity. The world has a texture and a sense of history so that players will always feel like they have something to experience and learn. We really want our players to engage in this story by expressing their own creativity and taking on challenges that will resonate with players in all realms. So this is something I'm really looking forward to because they do have developers that have worked on games like Dragon Age, Mass Effect, like they also say later in this article. And to me, that means that this game is bound to have some rich lore and backstory, and they even go further on that in the next question. In response to the question of why the Victorian setting for this survival crafting game, they say that some of us have spent time working on fantasy games like Dragon Age. We also made science fiction games like Mass Effect. This idea of anchoring fantasy in the Victorian era allows players to recognize certain things, but at the same time, by adding magic, mystery, and unknown races, the Fae, we can go in a fantastic direction and build a very interesting world. In response to can we expect a steampunk approach, they say no, we have decided to move away from steampunk. And then the article has the question of what were your main inspirations at the start of the project? And we talked about this in the previous video, but they said that one of their main inspirations was a book called Jonathan Strange and Mr. Norrell. It's a very beautiful fantasy story by Susanna Clarke about magicians who bring back magic to their world. And what we talked about in the previous video is that this is not only a book, but also a TV series, and I do plan on watching this one to get a better understanding of what to expect. The next portion ties into exploration, and the first part says that exploration seems to be one of the pillars of the game with this network of portals to be restored in order to discover the world. Can you tell us more about this mechanic? And their reply starts with, exploration is a fundamental part of the experience. We have decided to build a lot of realms and let players explore them. Players can unlock and open these portals, which allow them access to new realms, different realms, and potentially more difficult. Each kingdom is made up of a biome, forest, swamp, desert, and a unique terrain. Realms aim to provide a constant source of new adventures, new challenges, new rewards, and new discoveries. The more you explore, the greater the challenge. We want our players to feel that sense of progression, that sense of growing challenge as they go through and unlock more and more portals. This allows them to improve their base, unlock new features, improve their weapons and equipment, and give them more and more opportunities to complete more difficult challenges. You can do all this solo or with your friends. And then we see the question of how many different biomes can we hope to explore, to which they say that we can't reveal how many they'll have, but we have seen a sample of them. They're constantly expanding, and you can see some of the diversity of the biomes in the trailer. They then say, will it be possible to travel quickly on the map? And Inflexion Games says that they don't know at this stage if there will be any quick trips, they can't confirm this, but they do want the players to enter the world and feel connected or anchored to it. Personally, I kind of hope that they don't include any form of fast travels. I know that some sandboxes allow you to fast travel using your bedroll, but I kind of feel like for this one it would take away from the exploration part of it, and I also don't think that flying mounts would work as well here as they would in a game like Ark. The next section goes over the survival aspects. The first question is, what kind of threat can we expect to fight off in Nightingale? Their reply is that it starts with the world itself. The world can be very difficult, it has environmental challenges. This world can be welcoming and exciting at the same time, but also very difficult. There are all kinds of threats. There's terrain, the weather, of course there's enemy creatures like the one we see in the trailer. They even talk about how these zombie-like creatures running around are in fact attacking the base specifically, utilizing like a horde mechanic. We can also see trees coming to life in the trailer, and even giants that they have confirmed that we can be diplomatic with or hostile against. As far as a hunger and thirst mechanic goes, they said that they'll cover it in the near future. The world needs to put pressure on the player, and they say it can be very rewarding to find ways to overcome hunger, etc. I'm pretty sure they are going to incorporate a hunger system, because when they talk about the building system, they've also mentioned that we can build estates and farms. So if we're going to have ways of generating food, then we'll have to have something to use that on, unless it's going to be stamina regeneration, so I would imagine food would be the next best thing. The next question, is Nightingale a difficult game? They say that it's not the most difficult game ever created to date, but to reward players who discover new realms, there has to be a lot of challenges. Players need to find bigger challenges as they play and level up. There are very difficult, if not extreme, challenges to overcome. It will take a lot of cooperation, progression, preparation, and probably a little luck too. And then we come to the section of construction and crafting. And the first question is, building and crafting will obviously be a big part of Nightingale. Can you tell us how far the system goes? And they say, as with our realms, we want to develop this aspect. We want to give players more and more opportunities to express themselves creatively and let them come together and cooperate. You can invest in your own base, do exactly what you want, and express yourself in that base. You can also use buildings as strategy elements. If you attack a large creature, you can prepare reinforcements, ramparts, so basically block them in. You can go up high and attack from there. You can use buildings in different ways to defeat and achieve all kinds of things. And then we have three more sections, starting with the RPG dimension. And in a previous video, we went over some detail that talked about how we're going to have access to technology trees, so we'll be able to invest in our character, or we'll be able to get building blueprints for investing in higher tier stuff, so probably like stone or more durable resources than wood. The first question, and probably my most favorite, is can we expect RPG elements? How deep would these game mechanics be? And they say absolutely. The RPG elements enrich our game a lot. The ability to use traditional RPG elements like avatar customization is really cool. We have a lot of this kind of stuff, and there are plenty of choices for players. We put a lot of thought into role-playing games early on in the project when building Nightingale. And just to add on to that, this game was going to be an online RPG. And the second question, and I did get some comments about this kind of thing, can you tell us more about creating and customizing avatars? They say that it's vital that players can customize their character and make it their own. In the trailer, you can see different realm walkers who have walked through the portal and are standing there. They are all characters from the game. This gives you an idea of the variety of characters and outfits you can have. For me, I'm gonna be going for this one on the very right here. This one looks pretty sick. Or this one in the middle possibly, but we'll have to see how that looks on a male character. The second to last section has to do with magic. The first question is that there is a lot of fantasy in Nightingale. Will we have magical powers to fight enemies? And their answer is that there is magic in the game, a lot of abilities that players can invest in that they can unlock over time. You start out with next to nothing, but there are a lot of powers to be obtained and improved. This is something that was hinted at in the last video we talked about, but it looks like we have official confirmation that we will be getting access to magic, so I like the idea of that, and the fact that it's tied to the technology tree has me really curious to find out how much we're going to get exactly, because it sounds like a lot. Second question is, what is the source of magic in the Nightingale universe? They say that all magic comes from the Fae. Mankind has learned magic over the course of many centuries. Then the Fae were gone, and now they came back. Humanity must now rediscover this magic and understand how to use it. And the very last section dives into the multiplayer. And the first question is, does this game have an open world PvP system, or will it be possible to play online in PvE only mode? We already know the answer to this, but their reply is, this is player versus environment only for the moment, cooperative PvE. We make this experience great for our players so that they enjoy cooperating together. We are focused on this point now. Although I will say, even though we knew there was going to be no PvP, the way they worded it in the beginning, saying for the moment, makes me think that in the future, maybe there really will be realms that are going to be PvP flagged, if that's something that the player base wants, but we'll have to see. Second question is, how many players can be connected in the same world at the same time? They say that it's very important that our gaming community is always united. They don't want to divide us or put up artificial barriers between players that prevents us from playing together. I just want to say also that the video I was working on just before this was going to dive a little bit deeper into how big Nightingale could possibly expand its world in terms of player population. I do have some information I want to break down when it comes to that side of things, so we'll save that for next time, but I'm going to be very interested to find out more about this system. And the very last question is something we already know as well, but they wanted to know, how does cooperation work? What type of mechanics can we expect? They say that players can cooperate by collaborating in combat. They can build together. Villages are made by several players who cooperate and work together, which makes me wonder if they're talking about building a village in the sense of like you just place your house next to somebody else's, or if multiple players can come together and build something that stands on its own. But besides that, they also talk about the giant apex creature that we see at the end of the trailer. Looks like it's going to be a really big boss fight, and I do hope that we have more dynamic world bosses or field bosses that we can take down, because that's something that can be a ton of fun, especially if we're able to get at least 30 to 40 plus people all in the same place. But that's all we got for today, folks. Thank you guys so much, as always, for watching. Please let me know what you thought about this Q&A in the comments below. I'm really hopeful that we get some more information soon, and if we do, I'll be sure to cover that. You guys have a wonderful night or day. I'll catch you next time.